guest speakers, special guest, TISS, president, the executives, officials and members, ladies and gentlemen, and all other gallant people. In diplomatic circles and also in ELT's building circles, we also sometimes say all protocols observed. So tonight I also want to say all protocols observed to acknowledge our elders, our traditional leaders, our spiritual leaders, teachers, special guests, and others who may not be here with us physically but who continue to guide and bless us. So all protocols observed. My name is Florence Fong, I'm the MC tonight. I'm delighted to welcome you all tonight as we honor the life and legacy of Sadhguru Goswami, who inspired South Indians in Fiji to have pride in their culture and language, and also was very instrumental in the establishment of the Sangam organization. Before we begin our program proper, some housekeeping announcements first. The ladies and gents facilities are one floor below this current level, so you'll be exiting to your right to access those facilities. For the duration of the program, please request that you switch your mobile phones to silent mode, and if there's a very urgent call that you must take, we request that you please have that conversation out in the balcony. And also, in case there needs to be an emergency evacuation, we don't expect that to, but you just let me know. Please move to the space at the back of this building, away from the road. So with that out of the way, I wish on behalf of the organizers to apologize for the slight delay in us starting off tonight. But nevertheless, we have an exciting and a very rich program for us to all engage in. And I'll just give you a very quick overview of that. We'll begin with our traditional auspicious hand writing ceremony, which we do at all our Sangam functions to contribute to Lord Ganesha, the removal of obstacles, and to the Saraswati, the goddess for knowledge. And of course tonight, as we light that lamp, we'll be thinking of the founding father of Sangam, Sadhguru Goswami, in whose honor we are gathered today. Following this, there will be two cultural performances, and then we will get to the speeches. We'll hear from the officials of TISI Sangha, the President and the Secretary General, and then the centerpiece speeches, which will be the two speeches by Mr. Ramakrishnan Naidu and Mr. Richard Naidu, two generations of the Naidu family. And then, should time permit, and we certainly hope that there will be time, we will open the floor up a little bit for some reflections from you on what you would like to reflect on, the information that's been shared by the speakers, or any of your own thoughts that you may wish to share with regards to our the purpose of us being here tonight. And then at around 8 o'clock, or a little before that, we hope to conclude our program with a vote of thanks from the CEO of TISI Sangam. So as you can see, we have quite a small assortment of events in this program tonight. But first, let's get to our beer lighting ceremony. And we will request Mr. Ramakrishnan Naidu and Mr. Richard Naidu to do that. But before that, we have two lovely ladies who we request to please come up and garland the two gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you. thank you very much. And the two of you, Deepa and Justine, may I please request Mr. Ramakrishnan Naidu and Mr. Richard Naidu to officiate at the Lake Waidu Shrine, and perhaps Mr. Sarasimha Naidu for the Park Keeper. Thank you very much. We move to the next item on our agenda for tonight, and those are our classical performances. There are two classical dances. The first performance is the classical Kuchipudi dance, and it is one of the very fitting and auspicious occasions on which dances such as these are performed. It's a dedication to the Lord Krishna, showing his spiritual and charismatic character in a Rasa-lila style. It originates from Kuchipudi. The performer is Dia G, who hails from Hyderabad. She is well specialized in South Indian classical dance, Kuchipudi, and has been performing abroad and in Fiji as well, promoting her art as well as at the Sukumati Cultural Centre for the past 12 years. Ladies and gentlemen, this is DRG. Thank you. Thank you for that, the idea that was certainly a fine form. The second item is a part of Latin dance, which also originates from South India. Performed by artists who've gone intense training over many, many years. Tonight's artists have had extensive training locally as well as in India, and they are Yash Mahal and Zixi Lal. The dance they're about to perform depicts movements of spiritual blessings for the opening of events of the nature. The artists are regular performers and trainers as well at the Super Multicultural Center, and they perform under the guidance of their guru, Kalashri Sipur Malam. And all of their performances are coordinated by the Super Multicultural Center. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome these young ladies.
Thank you.
Silver Multicultural Center for those performances, and then a special acknowledgement to Mrs. Alexander for writing up some of the narrative on the panels for us. Our first speaker, ladies and gentlemen, is the National President of TNS Assembly, Mr. Sarasiva Naika. Mr. Naika, of course, needs no introduction to many of us. He's had a long and illustrious career in Fiji Customs Services and has also devoted much of his personal time in Sangam over many, many years in different capacities. I'm told that he served as the president of the Senior Sangam for 23 years before he moved on to serve in National Sangam at the national level. And his responsibilities included being general manager for 6 years, and now he is the current president, of course, which he's held for the past 7 years. He's also been president of TIB for a number of years, and I think that number also runs into double figures. So Mr. Naika is Mr. Sangam, I think. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Naika.
The President of NFP, Mr. Pio Kukanuwa, Mr. Mayor Nandu, Chairman of the Academy Board for Sangam College Basin, First Chairman of the Academy Board of Sangam College Basin, Dr. Ankin Swami, Mr. Mayor Paul Chowdhury, leader of the Fiji Labour Party, members of TID, Mata Sangam, TISI Sangam, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen. Namaskar and all. The Savitri Swami Day has been dedicated to the founder, Sevakratnam Savitri Swami. We have been commemorating this day in our schools.
Yes, I am
indeed overwhelmed to see the presence of many of our life members, former Sangam executives and representatives of the other faith-based organizations, academics, members of the diplomatic corps, members of parliament, and friends of Sangam tonight for this memorable occasion. Savitri Swami's life and his deeds are in itself is a living memory of his exemplary life and teachings. Today, our schools and temples around the country observe the Savitri Swami Day in the main centers of the day where Kireti, Bath, Motoka, Neni, Nandonga, Nasima, and Mombasa. All our students, teachers, and second members. However, in the past few years, it was realized that this day also includes all those pioneering members who helped form Sangam and trying to improve the life of many people around Fiji. TISI Sangam on this day also recognizes the contributions of organizations like Fiji Muslim League, Arya Patriotic Sabha of Fiji, the Sanatan Patriotic Sabha of Fiji, the Catholic Mission, the Methodist Church of Fiji, and all other faith-based organizations for their contributions towards the establishment of the educational institutes in this country. As the TISI Sangam, we have mentioned this previously, and I said this again, that government should get set aside a day to recognize all these individuals and organizations who have a vision to start the establishment of the educational institutes in Fiji. I am not calling for a public holiday, but a day for the students in every school to at least spend a few minutes of their time to say thank you to the founding fathers of various educational institutes. No one can discount the contributions of our founding fathers, of our educational institutions, without which the earlier generations of our people would have remained illiterate. The TLSR Center today salutes all our founding fathers for their foresight and selfless service in promoting of education and the preservation of culture and our languages. On behalf of TLSR Sangam, I only welcome you all for responding to our invitation to observe this and celebrate our Founders Day. Thank you very much. I hope you all will enjoy the program.
Close to 700 test receivers, And I'm also very proud to announce this evening that on the 21st of August, we will open our newest campus in Purdue. This organization, ladies and gentlemen, was formed through a vision of a very young person. Sadhguru Swami, who was around 26 years old, when he firmed up in his mind to improve the life of his community and equip the many children of the indentured laborers with the strongest weapons of education and preservation of culture, cultural and religious identity. When one reads documents and articles on the history and early days of the ISSN, there is a strong message that can be learned from the founding fathers of the organization. One of them is the intervention of spiritual guidance during the formation and development of Sangha. Secondly, the credibility of these men in managing the affairs of the organization, a clear and transparent way of managing conflict of interest. Sadhguru Swami, from what I have read about him, was a religious person and took upon himself the responsibility to serve his fellow indentured laborers. And whilst serving his intensive period working as a plowman for the Bangalore company, he read some books on Swami Vivekananda and got inspired by his teachings. Sadhguru Swami's rationale for initiating spiritual intervention into the lives of the many people around him and the Ashaya members was well met and very understandable. He was in the company of the people who on a daily basis were not only tasked with hard labor, but were subjected to verbal and physical abuse from the field officers or sardars of the CSR company. A note in Sadhguru Swami's diary, and as translated by Swami Rudranand and late Dr. Krishnamurti, said, and I quote, "Apart from regular hard work, the extent of abuse of men and women was a process. Such treatment prompted men and women to beat or kill the field officers of the sardars. Men were punished with jail terms or death sentences for such offenses. Another issue was the low percentage of women in the new community, and the ratio stood there, 4 men to 1 woman. Until, in such circumstances, ladies and gentlemen, with working hours from dawn to dusk, one would find it hard to practice one's own religion or even search for the meaning of life. Sadhguru Swami seemingly saw the need for spiritual liberation at the same time as he spearheaded efforts to form an organization to be known as Sangha. He planned the celebration of the birth anniversary of Swami Vivekananda in Vailaka Rakareti on 10th January 1926 and took the opportunity then to float the idea of forming the ISI Sangha. On 24th May 1926, when the ISI was finally formed, and motion to write to Ramakrishna Mission and to request the services of Swamiji to come to Fiji and assist the ISI Sangha in Fiji. The two other resolutions adopted at this meeting were: one, prepare children with education for the future requirement of the colony; two, it is neither political nor sectarian. It admits all irrespective of religion and caste, makes no distinction between rich and poor. Ladies and gentlemen, almost 10 years after the first request concerning a Swami, Reverend Swami Avinashananda arrived in Fiji on 21st May 1937. He was a person of great intellect and spirit solidarity. During his short term in Fiji, Swami Avinashananda guided Sangha to a unified organization and laid foundation for a properly and legally constituted body. Whilst the Reverend Swami, with the assistance of the founders and Mr. A. Patel, former leader of the National Federation Party and opposition leader, and also former general manager and legal advisor of TISR, continued with many programs to develop and expand some. But one of his outstanding legacies, and that is of Swami Avinashananda, inculcated among the households, which is still practiced by some tribal members in some districts and is worthy of recognition. The Pudiyasi, or the first handful of rice, was a project initiated by the Reverend Avinashananda. It was a handful of rice to be set aside before cooking and later sent to some centers to be used for others in need or feed students. It was with this knowledge that mothers in all South Indian homes would set aside a handful of rice prior to cooking. It was done with the knowledge that it was meant for the social upliftment and the process, in fact, enabling everyone to think of others' needs first. This was probably the first of a spiritual project that helped bind and unify Sangha groups around Jesus. A handful of rice, ladies and gentlemen, may sound small, but when this duty of dharma for the society is performed every day and at every home, then the collection was quite substantial. The students at the Navy Temple Hostel were major recipients of this handful of rice project. An entry by Mr. B.G. Pillay on the project said, and I quote, "Those who ate this rice never knew it came from, or never knew who it came from, and those who gave this did not know who ate it. And those who partook never felt indebted to one person, but to the society." Currently, ladies and gentlemen, this practice of a handful of rice is still practiced in Lumbasa. In Lumbasa, farmers put aside a bag of hay and they donate it to the TISR Center. And if you do visit Lumbasa, and to go to Lumbasa, at the back of the Lumbasa TISR Center office, they have in stock close to 2 to 3 tons of hay that is donated by the people of Lumbasa. Mr. Harilal Naik, who is from Lumbasa, is very proudly shaking his head. Ladies and gentlemen, Sadhu Kuswami had the services of some great men and women who had a clear focus of improving the lives of everyone around them, irrespective of race, religion, or creed. I have gone through many records and annual reports, only to be amazed on how, despite the trying and hard times, when Sangha was being formed, that any of the founders or leaders had acted in a questionable manner. One must remember that the CSR company had provided many sites to Sangam for schools and temples. And if you look at where all our schools are located, you will not find any trace of any ownership of land or property next or adjacent to any Sangam properties by any of the founding fathers of TISR Center. Sadhu Kuswami died with no ownership of any property. Whatever he did, selflessly, it was the TISR Center. I spoke to a group of students this morning, and I said to them, the people before us, the people like Sadhu Kuswami, and all the founding fathers of different schools, they, at that point of time, probably were not asking the question as to what do you want to become. They were asking the question, what is going to become of my society? And that's where they put all their energy in pushing for education for each and every one. Many of our members were also employed in the civil service, and a lot of them recused themselves from holding elected or executive positions, as it could have been a conflict of interest. I heard with great interest the address by former Governor General of New Zealand at our 2017 convention in Lombasa. Sir Anand Sathyanand had this to say, and I quote, "The records show that my grandfather, Muthuraya, was at the first meeting of TISR Center. However, I did not see his name in any position or membership register. To this, I can only say that he assisted in the formation of Sangam, but refused himself from the organization as he was a court interpreter. And his position would have been in conflict if one of his fellow members were in court and for him to discharge his duty." Leaders who followed and who worked with Sadhu Goswami had set exemplary qualities, and one such person was late Mr. MNA. TISR Sangam was registered under the ordinance, Companies Ordinance of 1913, on 6 January 1938, without the word limited. And the following subscribers were listed or still are listed for the company: Mr. MNA Trader, Lotoka; Mr. Mudriyar Trader of Bar; Tupuswami, priest of Nemi; Apapile, prayer of Suva; Krishna Reddy, planter of Nemi; Nagaswami, planter of Nemi; Parma Shetty, cultivator of Nemi. The application was dated 21st October 1937, and the signatures were witnessed by, again, Mr. A.D. Patel. Late Mr. Aaron Mandel, who was from South India, had set up his business in Lotoka around 1914, after spending some 7 years in Mombasa. In all our reports, in all our annual reports, there is this name of Mr. MNA, who is either cited for donating a piece of land, or assisting people, or building schools, etc. The native school in the morning in Lotoka was set up by Mr. MNA, and it was a free education center for the many youths of Lotoka and from eastern districts. And all those students or youth who were not able to find accommodation were accommodated at the native home and also given food and shelter. The formation of TISR Sangam can be largely attributed to the work of late Mr. MNA. It is also to be noted that when the first meeting of TISR Fiji was held, there were two names suggested for presidency. One of them was Mr. MNA, and the other one was Mr. B.M. Pillai. And because Mr. MNA had worked for Mr. B.M. Pillai prior to starting his business, both the gentlemen thought it would be proper that they both do not pursue the presidency, and thus Sadhu Goswami was elected the first president. Late Mr. Aaron Naidu actually convened the 1926 meeting, which was held from the 21st to the 23rd of May. And as per the public notice printed in the Fiji Times and Herald of 8 May 1936, it clearly states that the meeting was called by Mr. MNA. On May 24, 1926, Mr. MNA addressed the TISR meeting, and he said, and I quote, "We decided to form Sangam in January, and we held meetings in various places in Fiji. Our children are growing wild in Fiji due to the lack of education, culture, and illiteracy in our mother tongue. Therefore, we should try to establish schools for them, their learning, and their unity. I request all those in this conference to pay attention and consider this point. From his side, or from his goodness, he went ahead to donate furniture to various schools, including the Central School, started a library in it, and later donated the property to T.I. Sarsan. This property is in the heart of Delhi town. This is now being used by Ramakrishna Mission as an ashram and a medical center. He was a great philanthropist, and there is no property or property donated by Mr. Nayak that bears his name as a recognition of his donation. He always donated and never allowed his name to be put there. He also established the Tilakai School in Bhutan. The only approval that was bestowed upon was from T.I. Sarsanga, and he was given the honor with the title Dandi, which translates to overwhelmingly generous. An honor given to him in 1941 on the same stage as Sarukutuswami was given the title of Sevaka. Ladies and gentlemen, in the lifetime of Sarsanga, these are the only two gentlemen that have been honored for their services to Sarsanga. And it is with great pleasure, and I'm pretty sure that we will all join and say that we welcome Mr. Ramakrishna Naidu, the son of late Mr. M. Naidu, and Mr. Richard Naidu, son of Mr. Ramakrishna Naidu and grandson of Mr. M. Naidu. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much.
Mr. Ramakrishna Naidu was born in Watoka in 1927. In July this year, he celebrated his 90th birthday. Mr. Naidu is the last surviving child of Mr. N. N. Naidu, one of the founding fathers of Sangha, and was its first vice president. Mr. Naidu's early education was at schools in Watoka and Mandi. His final years of schooling were in Wangarei, New Zealand. He holds degrees in agricultural science from Allahabad University in India and from Massey University in New Zealand. He began his career in the 1950s as an agriculturalist in government service at the Sinatoka Research Station, moving later to Coronelia near Nosori. In 1964, he went into business and for many years as a dairy farmer in Galenovesi near Lani, where his son Richard and his daughter Joanna were raised. In 1974, Mr. Naidu returned to work in the Department of Agriculture as an agricultural officer, finishing his career in 1987 as Principal Agricultural Officer, Animal Health and Production at the Agriculture Department headquarters in Suva. During this time, he was seconded to the South Pacific Commission as a consultant on integrated farming methods. Mr. Naidu worked on and consulted to many farming projects, integrated farming projects, throughout most of the South Pacific countries. Upon his retirement from government service in 1987, Mr. Naidu became an agricultural consultant working for private businesses and international organizations such as the South Pacific Commission and the Food and Agricultural Organization. Mr. Naidu remains a keen amateur botanist and gardener, even at the young age of 90. He continues to take a strong interest in agriculture in Fiji, particularly the dairy industry. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Mr. Francis.
Is much written about in the Sangam history. My father was born in Kentucky, in Kennebec, district in Kennebec. He came to Fiji in 1907 as an indentured laborer and served his indenture in Mombasa. My father did not talk very much about us to ask about indenture. We recalled only that he had to work hard like all other indentured laborers. He recalled one to me, only one incident where he was punished because one of his fellow workers could not finish his task, which was to dig a drainage. My father helped him, but the overseer said that the other worker was lazy and for both of them, and both of them were punished with extra work. After his indenture, my father moved to Lutuka. This was when Mr. William Pillay, I don't know if many people know him, he was a merchant in Lutuka. He invited him to help him on his business. So my father came across to Lutuka. Now, however, they didn't get on too well. So after some 8 to 10 months later, my father walked out of there and decided to set up his own business. There's some, a little bit of written about my father in your handouts, so I'm not going to tell you too much about his other activities. He had shops in Nandi, in Bar, and Lutuka. He owned property in Nandi. He also owned a small farm in Grasa and ran a small shop during the war years. You know what happened in the war years? A lot of people who lived in town areas, had to move into the rural areas, because the Japanese were actually closing in on Papua New Guinea. My father was very interested in cattle. He always had some cattle on his little property, bought through CSI company. And this is where my interest in dairy started. And the interest in farming was developed. It was why I qualified in agriculture science and later became, for a while, for some 30 years, a dairy farmer. I left the ministry while working at Carnegie because I felt the way doing. Yeah, I decided to go independently. Unfortunately, after 30 years, I lost my lease, so I had to return back to agriculture. Over time, however, my father became more involved in selling and less involved in his business. He virtually gave away his shop in Bar and Nandi to his relatives. In Bar, to his namesake, grandson, a shop which he ran as a manufacturing Indian sweets. In Nandi,
where the bus stand is, my father gave his property to his brother-in-law, Sundar Gandhi. And he donated much of his land in that December over the years. You know, where the Nandi Sangha school stands today, my father negotiated the land for himself, but eventually gave it away to Sangha. It belonged to Sisa. He finally retired in India in the early 50s. He passed away there in 1966 at the age of 86. My father never spoke English. Some of you will know Pandit Vishnu, who was a Let's Go member in the colonial days from the Central Division. He taught at my father's private school. And he tried to make my father learn English. But my father was too busy. You know, while he spoke Tamil, Telugu, Hindi, and Ethiopian language, he decided that. Because he was well educated, he was respected in the community. This perhaps has been succeeding in his business. However, I feel my father was not a very good businessman. He was not very interested in his business. He felt a strong obligation to help others. He associated with other community leaders, such as T.A.J. Chile. Some of you will know of him, the father of Mr. C.S. Pillay, who was the first General Secretary of National Federation. There was Krishnasamy Naipaul, and then the merchant. There was Krishna Reddy, who was the father of Mr. Subba Reddy, who you will know was also a nominated member of the an Indian nominated member of the Legislative Council in the colonial. Then there was Subba Naidu from Nandi and Unni Sardar, also of Nandi, and Madhavan Nair. And of course, back then, in the early 20s, there were no formal Sangam organization. Sangam was created in 1926. The year before I was born. However, it didn't have any legal status. It was only in 1937 when, with the help of Swami Abhinashananda and Mr. A.E. Chow, it was imposed. Swami Abhishananda stayed in our home whenever he can get to do it. I remember some small incidents. I remember that he was a very fussy eater. He didn't like rice very much.
So my mother had to cook some roti. And the roti had to be fried in ghee, almost cracking. And this community, I'm just the kind of person he was. I remember Swami Ramakrishna Ananda also was deeply concerned about the plight of our Indian authority. There were the years of the Great Depression. I can remember Depression pretty well. And this was a time when my father gave away a lot of food from his shop because there was virtually no sales. Nobody had money to buy anything. People were not poor, so poor that they could buy food anywhere. My father used to give us sometimes money to walk down to the bakery, a bakery run by a Chinese art form, to buy bread for some of our cultivating. Swami Avinashananda arranged to bring two people from India to support him. My father paid their classes, and one of them was Ramakrishna Aiyar. Ramakrishna Aiyar was a teacher, and later in the car, he wanted to send him to a man. I'll talk more about him later. The other was Swami Udayananda. Swami Udayananda was a frequent guest in our home. Very knowledgeable, and especially in cultural and music. What I remember often, now every Friday between 7 and 8 p.m., we would lead budget at Sangam boarding school. Boarding house in Nandi. The boarding house was just on the banks of the Nandi River. At the time, we were young, and as best students, we also joined the body. You know, used to, as a 10 and 12 year old, because it was conducted between 7 and 8 in the evening, some of us just couldn't keep awake because sitting cross legged. And he would sing, he was a very good singer. He sang many different songs, and a couple of them I can still remember. One was it said, it starts, Ragupatira, Jawara, Jara, Ampatita, Pauna, Sitara, and we all follow. And then he actually goes differently. And then it comes down and narrow down. Now, this, along with other budgets, would continue for almost an hour. And half of us would be virtually asleep. And all of a sudden, we'd wake up with last song. Every time we heard And because soon after, we all hear the silence. And that's what we normally came into to have that in the budget. However, over time, family becomes was often invited by the rural community to speak to them on cultural matters, on religious matters and so forth. What hurt him most was the poor facilities and the poverty he saw among our people. At the same time, a lawyer in Nandi, Mr. Andy Patel, who was a member of the, who was a National Federation Party's representative in the Legislative Council, who tried trying to champion the cause of Indian people, because the colonialists, Indian people were marginalized. So when Kupusami saw that, he decided to combine with Mr. Patel and try and work out wherever he could to have the certainty. And this, unfortunately, took away a lot of his time from Sangha activities. And this is where my father fell out of it. And also, my father was a bit concerned because at that time, Brunanda, who was part of the Ramakrishna Mission in India, felt that they were trying to take over Sangha. He was particularly concerned about this activity. Swami Vivekananda became more and more involved in politics and less in Sangha activity. My father with many, associated with many of the Gurdwara, well-known personalities at the time. There was Ajit Patel, a lawyer in Ludhiana, and he was friends with Nandi lawyer, the future MP leader, Ajit Patel. Most Saturdays or Sundays, these two used to play tennis in Ajit Patel's court. Like 2 doors away from the office. And we were called upon, my brother and I were called upon to be born. So we knew these people very, very well. Now, our home was in the Vitti Street with a very large family. We were 10, 9 boys and 1 girl. Many of you may remember my younger brother, N.K. He was general secretary of Sangha for virtually, I don't know, about 10, just a few years. In that very day, who didn't see Mohit Mahapala, he was heavily involved in his business and, of course, like other children in the neighborhood, were busy with family life, school, and play. We got to know my father better in his later years when he had left TV and turned to him. I studied agriculture at the University of India, and in the early 50s, it was when I spent a lot of time with him in Madurai, and we traveled very extensively down the south, or went to know where he lived before we came to Sweden. Of course, we saw that, of course, the place had completely changed. This was when I got to know more about his involvement in summer. That's the first time I get a lot of details of family activity and the people who were so much involved. I think that's how it's decided. We spent a lot of time with my father. Now, some people say it's hard to find me. Walk barefoot from place to place, it's quite cheap. But in most instances, because they live in Rajaraja, if you ever come to Nandi, you're always driven by the sugar refining company's field train, which used to start in Yokota on a Monday, go to Ba, Gabua, to Rakilaki, Wellington Harbour, and back the same day. And we stopped almost in front of our shop. And invariably, we find Tadi Kupusami stepping out with his black umbrella. And we stayed with my father for maybe 3-4 days, and then we decided to go to Nandi. We always continuously coming in and going out of Nandi, and we would do it. When he was in the house, he and my father would spend hours together. We'd be talking about Sangam and his struggles. Over time, Sangam became more important to my father than his business. His business was very successful because it brought two people from India. One was Venkat Ramanujam Naidu, was a distant cousin of his, and another distant cousin, Lakshman Philip. Now, some of you in Sula will know Venkat Ramanujam. Later on, became V.R. Jain in China. As children, we did not have very much to do with Sangha. He would speak to us in Tamil. We would become annoyed if he heard us speaking in other language among ourselves. And of course, as children, we mix freely with children with our elders. In our part of the Joker, we were the only Southerners. There were Chinese, there were Black Europeans, a lot of Gujaratis, and we were all spoke either our type of English and there were the architects, bards, generals, prayers, agency, care, warm chain, candles, and others. The Swami criticized us for speaking, you know, in a language he couldn't understand. So what he used to do, he called us in time. Kurvita, mean bird. This used to upset us. Sangam politics also affected our schooling. Most of my primary school was spent at St. Thomas Primary School in New York. This school was very close to our home, so we could just walk there. But people in Sangam community criticized us. They said that MNIU children could not have been invited to a Catholic school when he was vice president of Sangam and spent so much money on Sangam. So what do you think my father did? So my father said that we should go to Lomu Sangam School, which was 3 miles away. So we would be taken to the school 3 miles away in my father's truck. The truck would return to school with our lunch, then he would come again to pick us up in the afternoon. This went on for several, almost 8 months. Then, of course, because we were upset as children, because he took us away from our friends at St. Thomas School, finally my father and told us to return to St. Thomas School. Now, the Sadhu, as I said earlier, we've known him very well because he used to be in our proper place from time to time. The Sadhu is described in Sangam history as a modest man like Mahatma Gandhi. You know, Mr. Nehru, the first Prime Minister of India, once joked that it cost him a lot of money to keep Mahatma Gandhi in poverty. For years, I'm sure that my father could say the same about Sadhu. Being a sadhu, he never carried money. He refused to even touch money. Every time the sadhu would leave our home to travel to Nandi, he would take the bus owned by Mr. Sapulin. But one of us had to take that money and give it to the driver because he refused to hand it. Even authority, 2 shillings. It used to annoy us because, you know, sometimes we'd be engaged in some sports or do something. My father would call us Yeah, they did much. Go along with that and pray the Bible. In 1939, when I was 12, my older brothers and I moved to Nanny to attend Sunday school. You know, our home was across the road from the Nanny European Tennis Court. Some of you will know, I think the court is still there. They played tennis, and at the back of this tennis used to be the race court, which I understand is in South Florida. Now, when he took over Nanny Simmons School as headmaster, this was Mr. Ramakrishnan, who arrived in Fiji to where Swami Ramakrishnan was. He was a remarkable teacher, perhaps the most brilliant of these in my opinion. Ramakrishnan Iyer was posted to Nanny Simmons School in the 40s as headmaster. There he invited some very good Indian, South Indian teachers as his staff. Many of the names of these teachers you may recognize. One was K.S. Reddy. Later, he became a nominated member of the legislative council. He was Michael Pillay, who left teaching when he did law and became a chairman general in Guatemala. He was Tony Gopalan. He resigned from China and became an education officer. The Grammar Nair was appointed as High Commissioner of the Year Treasury. And we are going to learn who became a senior counsel in public works department and so on. There were others, there was Subramani Nagar, there was Sami Rao, there was Chiloma, and a couple of lady teachers. But Ramakrishnan, BALT, that considered a Bachelor of Arts degree, and also a licensed teacher in India, he showed it both the primary and secondary school. He was the head teacher of his time. He came to supervise his teachers. He helped in the teaching of vernacular language, such as Tamil, Telugu, and because there were so many Gujarati students in Tamil, he asked the Gujarati community to provide a Gujarati teacher to teach Gujarati. He also encouraged us in public speaking and with a synergy. Yeah. I think I also understood the importance of sport. If you are going to tennis, you can play with the tennis ball. You need to be available for the tennis. And you can play a school. I understand volleyball is played for the first time. You organize sports between the three primary schools in Nandi, the third Sangam, Andrew School, and Korubuti. He encouraged arts and craft. He encouraged gardening at school. And although some of these activities, while they were extra, the education department wasn't very happy. But if this carried on, this may seem to be small things now, but in our time, there's not much help available from government. People were poor, they had very little money. So these were important things. It happened because of the strong leadership in the school. This built up the community spirit of teachers and parents. I remember how Ramakrishnan organized an 8-day trip around the level for a 12 senior student and a teacher. Some of my fellow students were my two brothers, first Shubhakani Maran, from Mutusani Ganga, from Rajavati, Vendor Vedi, Satyayu, there was Ram Kumar, Ramana, Chengaya, there was Yaraj, there was Dominic Nair, and Joseph Hassan. You know, individually, we were not like today. This was a long trip. We visited the sugar mills, went to Kuala Lumpur, then to the station in Missouri. Back then, the Missouri police station was nearly built to describe of Missouri at the time. In Sugar, we visited Public Library, the museum, two factories, a biscuit, the soap making factory, three times, botanical garden, and a few other spots. In Abua, we visited two rice farms and the Fiji Pasta Company, now the Fiji Cop Company. Every night, children were benefited with charge of independence. So there is no cost for China. In Sinatoga, we visited the agriculture station in the village. But then it became difficult to organize such trips. Communication was poor and travel was difficult. So this shows great commitment from our teachers and the study community. These were the opportunities that Sangam made available to young people, even at the time when schooling was limited and many families had very little money. Now, something I'm going to tell you right now, and that was, as I said, 77 years ago. Ramakrishnan was also a very cynic man. One day, I can recall very distinctly, in 1940, he called in all the teachers and seniors of our country. He said, we were appalled by the amount of rubbish that he saw on the streets of Nairobi, like papers, empty cans, bottles, and shopkeepers' waste and so forth. He asked us to volunteer the following Saturday to clean it up. On that Saturday, we rang with the shopkeepers in Nairobi to provide empty sacks for us. We set off from the top end of Nairobi, right down to the old Nairobi Bridge and side streets for it to go. But what amazed us at the time, the district officer of Nairobi at the time was filled snow. Some of you who are interested in cricket would know he lived at the end of best cricket in England. He used to organize cricket coaching in Nairobi. And during this time in Nairobi had the prestigious trophy in cricket, the Niwas Shield. Now I understand it's in Pingo in love. Now, this district officer, he got around very well with my cricket. He saw what was going on, and as we students walked down the main street of Maine, we were surprised to see him with an ambition, holding an empty sack and doing what we were doing. I wonder these days how many town administrators would do the same. When our Sangha's aim, when it was formed, was to promote the development of South Indian languages. So it is perhaps a shame that we are now all speaking to each other in English. But Sangha today is a major contribution to the whole Fiji community. I think that my father would have been very proud of what it has achieved from its humble being back then. The lessons that we can learn from Sangha history are that an organization does not succeed on its own. It depends on people who are community-minded and prepared to work. People who do not need recognition or pain.
Storytelling and stories of old,
as they're told by our elders, and we appreciate that, Mr. Lowry. I'm sure I speak for everybody when I say you've gained valuable insight on Sundance values through your lived experiences. And through your stories, there are many lessons for us in terms of the importance of hard work, education, dedication to community, and service to fellow men. It's now time for Richard Nighy, ladies and gentlemen. And it gives me great pleasure to introduce Richard. Richard Krishnan Nighy is a lawyer and a partner in the law firm Munro Hees. He was born in New Zealand and completed his secondary schooling in Suva and in Wales. After completing secondary school, he worked as a journalist at the Fiji Times between 1982 and 1987, in part while studying in New Zealand. Soon after the 1987 military coup, Mr. Nighy worked for Dr. Timothy Babangida, the deposed Prime Minister, as his secretary and spokesperson, but was forced to leave Fiji in 1988. He then returned to New Zealand and completed his studies, gaining degrees in accountancy and from the University of Auckland. Between 1988 and 1994, he worked in two large firms in New Zealand and returned to Fiji in 1995 when he joined Munro Hees. He has worked at Munro Hees since then. Mr. Nighy is principally a commercial lawyer. However, he continues to appear in court on special cases. Over the years, this has included contempt of court, news media, tax, commercial, and judicial review cases. He has served on the boards of a range of non-governmental organizations, such as Transparency International and Fiji Red Cross Society, and also as a legal advisor to a range of community organizations and sporting bodies. He has in the past served as a council member of the Fiji Law Society and currently holds office on the committee of the International Bar Association. Mr. Nighy takes an interest in and occasionally writes and speaks on issues such as media freedom, good governance, law, and economic issues. He is married with three children. He has, after a break of 20 years, taken up road running as his new sport. However, he says he is quite ashamed that even though he's only 54, he could not outrun the famous 66-year-old veteran athlete, Sri Chand Mushroom, in the last Suva Half Marathon last month. Better luck next time, Richard. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Richard Nighy.
First of all, I would just like to thank someone on behalf of my father and me for the great honor you've done both of us by inviting us to speak at this Founders Day event. And you know, there was a risk to invite a lawyer to speak to you because lawyers charge by the hour. So they expect to speak for minimum of 1 hour. But I assure you that I'm not going to take that long. I don't really intend to do any more than just offer a few reflections on what my father has talked about, like a postscript. So as you've heard, Sundance is literally in my blood. I don't feel that I personally have contributed to this great organization the way I should have. Over the last year, however, some of you know, I have been requested to serve as Sundance as a lawyer. The circumstances of that are not ideal. Organization is facing some challenges. But we also know that Sundance has faced many challenges in its 90-year history. Its success as an organization shows that it is equal to those challenges. It's a greater organization than any one person or group of people, so I think these current issues will, like many before them, just pass into history. I am a history student from my school days, and to this day I am still fascinated by history. So my father explained to me how, I explained to you how he learned more about his father's life in his father's later years. And so now it is actually my turn. Now I talk to my own father about his life and times. And as you have heard from him, he has many stories about life in the 1930s and 40s, and of course for all of us, for our fathers and grandfathers, we have similar stories. Many of these are lost to history. But I prefer history and human stories, because I think it's important that we understand that with admiration. People such as the founders of Sangam, they were also human beings. They were imperfect people, their own qualities and their own imperfections. And so what it means is that they were people like us, just ordinary human beings. And if they were people like us, then perhaps we can try harder to be more like people like them. Because our contributions too can be important and significant. Indeed, they need to be important and significant. We can only honor the work of those who have come before us by continuing and improving on what they have done now in the present. As we all know, history serves another useful purpose. No organization can understand where it is going without a clear understanding of where it has been. So there is a lot that we can learn from the past, and so it remains. This century, the challenges are different, but history still offers valuable lessons on how humans should answer them. First, I'd like to make this point. We should understand and respect and encourage the great power of voluntary organizations in our community. You know, these days, the modern description for a voluntary organization is an NGO, a non-governmental organization. But that, for me, seems to be a very sterile sort of term. I prefer community organization, because community organizations are formed from and they're supported by the community. Their members are volunteers. Their members are not just doing a job. They're committed and motivated. Their voluntary work often reflects their individual experience. It is work they choose to do. This seems to be a time when we look to the national government to do everything and give us everything. And in some ways, the national government seems to prefer it that way. Certainly, we need to have taxpayer funded education and health, and for the government to build us better roads and water supplies. And certainly, in the years since independence, things have greatly improved for our people and their quality of life. But the refinements on those things, the things that actually make the difference, often come, almost always come from other human beings. These might be individual acts of kindness. There might be special help where it was most needed. Many of us, as my father does, have memories of outstanding school teachers who took a special interest in us or who motivated us in some way. And this is where the volunteer organizations are the best. And I'm just reflecting on a comment that the national president made about how there should be a day set aside where voluntary organizations are celebrated and commemorated, and people encouraged to join them, and people encouraged to look at the opportunities that organizations have. But perhaps as great as the material benefits to the community organization brings are the strengths that come from self-reliance. Let us reflect on how Sangam built itself from next to nothing. Those were days when there were very few government grants or foreign aid. People worked together because if they wanted to improve their lives and the lives of their children, they had no choice. Everyone had to contribute their labor, everyone had to contribute their money and their other skills, as they had the means to do, whether the project was a school or a temple or some other community asset. And the result of that, because people were not given things, because people worked for things, and they built things, was surely a great sense of pride and ownership in what they had built and what they owned, and a commitment to keeping it and maintaining it and preserving it. And this is how community spirit is built and how leadership is developed. Organizations such as Sangam are where community leadership is most effectively taught. the ability to motivate and encourage people to act in the service of others, and to put their skills and resources to that use. Building and maintaining an organization which values self-sufficiency and independence, and encourages those skills in others, is just so important. Perhaps you would allow me just for 1 minute to put on my lawyer's hat. Because it is interesting, looking back at Sanlam, and the history of Sanlam, that Sanlam was formed in 1937 as a company. You do not think of a voluntary organization as a company. But I would like to have been in that room when Mr. A.D. Patel gave that advice to the founders. Because I suspect that he would have said at that time, this is the best and the only legal structure that I can recommend to you. And I have to say that 80 years later, the advice would be no different. That is the same advice that I've given to a number of non-profit organizations over the years. And so what we actually need is a new law. We need a new law that perhaps creates a concept like an incorporated society, as they have in New Zealand and Australia. Because that would be a great service to people who are looking for a simple and uncomplicated way to incorporate and operate voluntary organizations. It would enable people to operate lawfully and with a legal structure and to obtain funding and other support and account to their membership without needless formalities and paperwork. Because all of us who have served in administrative positions, all of you who have served in administrative positions in Sanlam, you know that the accounting and the paperwork and the record keeping, that is a boring and unglamorous side of community service. And many people are actually discouraged from creating voluntary organizations simply by the sheer complexity of the laws and the governance that surround them. They want to do things in the community. They don't want to do paperwork. They don't want to fill out forms. They don't want to get their police clearance and their tax identification numbers. So we should be encouraging some dialogue with the government on laws that will encourage volunteers and community service organizations, not rules and complexities that continue to restrict them. The founders of Sanlam place huge importance on education. They have the foresight and the vision to understand that education is critical in so many ways to human progress. First of all, it was important economically, because it was a way that young people could find secure livelihoods in an unsecure environment. This was, remember, these were times when people could never be sure of access to land and where they had small farms, could not support all members of the family. But as we've already heard from my father, schools were also places where students could acquire general knowledge. They could learn to be better citizens. They could learn the importance of sport. And as all of the social indicators show, education enables people to negotiate life's challenges better, to be more adaptable, and to better understand their own rights. Tens of thousands of Fiji citizens of all races, of all religions, of all walks of life have passed through Sanlam schools. And for me, that is one of Sanlam's greatest achievements, education. And yet, as Sanlam explores and markets success, the challenges for educators continue to grow. You know, these days the pace of change in the world is getting faster and faster. We're now entering a period in which machines are replacing many jobs at the lower levels of education. And even things like artificial intelligence are threatening the jobs, even of professionals like us, when we thought we were immune. So no person who young or old is guaranteed a job anymore. Certainly no person is guaranteed a job for life. So we have to ask, do we have a national education system that is prepared for these challenges? And if we do not, what can organizations like Sanlam, who are so important in education in this country, who are leaders in education, what can we do about it? How should we be thinking? How should we be planning for the future? Health is now a national challenge. In common with many other countries, non-communicable diseases, NCDs, diabetes, heart disease, is now a lower life expectancy. They degrade people's quality of life, and they reduce their ability to use their skills and talents productively to provide for their families. And of course, there are government initiatives to help with this and they should be supported. But what can organizations like them do? It's not just in the schools anymore. What about the communities that they influence? What can some of them do for public health? And finally, I want to reflect on one more challenge, a little bit more controversial, but I think it's important. Because this is a scenario that now may even take us backwards into someone's history. And I'm referring to the challenges now facing the sugar industry. For 40 years, our sugar has had the benefit of access to Europe at prices that are well above the world market price. Only yesterday came the news that we have always known would happen, that this arrangement is finally now at an end. So in a sense, Fiji sugar industry is on its own. It has no more support. We've known this day is coming for many years. Successive governments have done very little or nothing about it. And now, some feel it may be too late. What we know is that our sugar will no longer produce the impact that we used to receive. And we cannot simply pretend that for the communities that depend on this industry that nothing will change. Of course it will change. The industry may recover. Some people are optimistic. But it's also likely that many people whose lives depend on this industry face a prolonged period of hardship. The cane belts of Fiji are where someone was born, where it still thrives, where it plays an important role in community life. And this is a new challenge, it seems to me. This is a place where someone will need to help. So someone is not new to challenges. Family's history for the last 90 years has been about responding to those challenges. It may be in its history that someone can reflect about those challenges and where its responses to those challenges may come. So thank you again for listening to me, and good evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Richard. It's always a pleasure to hear Richard speak. We call it as it is, and it shows that there are challenges for all of us to consider our own actions based on values and principles, but at the same time, to be keenly aware of the context in which we all live in and operate in. We're almost at the end of our program, ladies and gentlemen. And at this point, I'd like to invite the CEO of Sunland Fiji, Mr. Jane Ryan, to please come up to move the budget plans.
His Excellency the High Commissioner of New Zealand, Justice Jairan Reddy, the former legal advisor of PISS, the National President, Secretary General, and the National President of the then India Mother Sangam, executives of PISS Sangam, the leader of the National Federation Party, Dr. Biman Prasad, and the President of the National Federation Party, Mr. Piyo Chikundundura, former Prime Minister of Fiji, Mr. Nandapa Choudhury, dignitaries, special guests, ladies and gentlemen, namaskaram to one and all. It is a privilege and honor for me to extend a vote of thanks tonight on behalf of the National President and the executives of the PISS and Fiji. This evening itself is a memorable occasion for the PISS Sangam, as we pay homage to Sir Sadhu Kupaswamy, who was the leader of the founding fathers of Sangam. In 1961, so 56 years ago, the then general manager of the PISS Sangam, Swami Rupananda, sent a circular to all our schools and temples that the 2nd of August every year is set aside to celebrate the life and works of Sadhguru Swami. Since then, the 2nd of August has become a significant event in the calendar, of the PISS. This event has grown over the past years, and since 2010, the occasion has been marked at a national level by the PISS. In 2015, for the first time, the Sadhguru Swami Memorial Lectures were launched by the PISS Sangam in collaboration with the School of Education, Faculty of Arts, Law and Education, and the School of Governance, Development and International Affairs at the University of the South Pacific Lodhara campus. Sangam over the years has promoted education, culture and spirituality through the several schools, temples, village mandalis, and the annual national conventions of PISS Sangam, thus living the vision and legacy of the founding fathers of Sangam. We have had an extremely useful evening tonight, learning a great deal and very much indebted to the two speakers who have discussed in depth the selfless sacrifices of the founders of Sangam. Tonight, we are privileged to also have Mr. J. Ram Reddy, a life member and former legal advisor of the PISS Sangam, for specifically taking out his time to attend this evening's program. I also wish to accord our hearty appreciation to all our honored guests and participants for making this evening a memorable one. Your presence is a testimony of the high regard and respect that we pay to the founding fathers of not only this organization but all other organizations, and we honestly feel that this platform will grow as we need to recognize the contribution of the founders of not only this organization but all other organizations. I must take this opportunity to thank especially Mr. Sadasiva Naikar, the National President of PISS Sangam, Mr. Devendra Gowda, the Secretary General of PISS Sangam Fiji, for initiating the program for this evening and to pay tribute to our founders. They have been tirelessly working to organize this evening's function. I must also commend the time and efforts of the organizing committee, Dr. Nilesh Gowda, Mr. Andrea Naidu, Mr. Ravindra Swami, the President of Subha Sangam, Mr. Dalit Kumar, Mr. Balram Nair, and the Subha Sangam in assisting the head office in organizing this event here in Subha. To all those who have contributed in one way or the other for tonight's occasion, my sincere appreciation to you all. I also acknowledge the presence of the media and thank them as well. Once again, before concluding, let me express our sincere gratitude and appreciation to the keynote speakers. Especially, we are very fortunate tonight to have Mr. Ramakrishna Naidu, the only surviving son of late Mr. M. Naidu, whose contributions towards founding and building of Sangam have been immense. And thus, in 1941, as mentioned by the Secretary General, at a meeting of the PISS Sangam, Mr. M. Naidu was honored with the title of the MD. To Mr. Nathan Naidu, thank you very much for your contributions and we wish to continue to see your presence in Sangam. With this, I'd like to thank you all once again for attending this occasion tonight, and also on this occasion, the Sadhguru Swami Memorial College in Indy has launched a learning resource for our children with which they have depicted the life and the deeds of Sadhguru Swami. We have got some limited copies to circulate for people to get it. Once again, thank you very much. Please enjoy the rest of the evening and your dinner to put you back in from here. Thanks.
Thank you very much for coming and I wish you
to the evening.